I don't know what you've been told, but time's running out, no need to take it slow. I'm stepping to you toe to toe. I should be scared, honey, maybe so, but I ain't worried about it right now. Keeping dreams alive, hey, 1999 heroes. I ain't worried about it right now. Swimming in the floods, dancing in the clouds below. I ain't worried about it. You've been told, but time's running out, so spend it like it's gold. I'm living like a noisy rose, got no regrets even when I'm broke. Hey, I'm at my best when I got something I'm wanting to steal. Way too busy for them problems and problems to feel. No stressing, just obsessing, sealing the deal. I'll take it in and let it go, but I ain't worried about it right now. Keeping dreams alive, 1999 heroes. I ain't worried about it right now. Swimming in the flats, dancing in the clouds below. I ain't worried about it. Keeping dreams alive, hey, 1999 heroes. I ain't worried about it right now. Swimming in the floods, dancing in the clouds below. I ain't worried about it.
Good evening and welcome to a packed Hastings Stadium for Game 5 of round number 1 between the Guelph Royals and the Hamilton Cardinals. Scott Fraser joined in the booth by Neil Srivastava. And Neil, we didn't expect to be here once this series kicked off about a week ago, but my oh my, it has been really a tale of two different teams on any given night. Guelph dropping Game 1 about 6 days ago on home field, just their third loss in this stadium all summer long, and the bats went dead silent between game 1 and 2. They came alive between 3 and 4, 34 runs scored in game 3 and 4 combined, and all of a sudden we have a win or go home scenario. Ace on ace, it's Sam Turcotte for the Hamilton Cardinals, and guess who? Claudio Custodio for the Guelph Royals. Claudio has been tireless all season long. What do you expect from this matchup, which is really kind of a mirror image of that game one lineup for both sides?
Well, Keenan's going to be the scorer early and often for either team. Whoever gets the lead early is probably going to be sitting a little bit more comfortable, a little bit more relaxed for the inning here, but, you know, you just got to capitalize on whatever mistakes get made here.
And, again, Claudio Custodio, talk about a MVP. We will pause for the anthem, and we'll get touch more on that in a moment. A fantastic rendition of our country's national anthem to get everyone on their feet and get the energy pumped right up. As we were saying right before.
Again, yeah, just crazy. He does such a great job. Of course, he works with the Canadian Opera House. A Juno Award winner as well, so just great to have him here. Of course, he's the dad of Ryan and Gabe Braun as well, or Ben Braun, sorry.
And as you mentioned, right after the anthem finished, 2-0. With him singing, so he's a good luck charm, and why not? He brought the energy into this building. Claudio Custodio, he pitched in this on this ballpark on Tuesday night. He also hit for himself in that ball game. He played in the outfield or in the field in game 4. He will once again pitch here tonight. You would have to think if Guelph can find a way to get a quick lead, Dino Ramel would be very, very happy to yank him out of the game ASAP. Considering game one would be tomorrow night for both Hamilton and Guelph, depending on what happens in this one.
No question, as far as that stuff goes, you got to save some arms as much as possible, but you got to go all hands on deck as much as possible tonight. Anyways, you got to win there to get there. So everything's all up on the board tonight, as far as that stuff goes.
And on the other side, Sam Turcotte, who was just perhaps the best pitcher that the Royals have faced all season long last Saturday. He silenced those bats that were so deadly in game 1 and really sucked the wind out of the Royals' sails coming into the postseason and kind of shocked the world with his performance. And at the plate for the Hamilton Cardinals, look at the guy batting third. The center fielder, Tyler Duncan, has been lights out, power on power on power, and has been consistent with it.
He's just definitely he's found that next level, especially when the postseason, when it mattered the most for this Cardinals team. He's found a way to help them get going in pretty much every game so far in this game, in the series. So if we can shut him down tonight, the Royals have a good chance.
Yeah, and on the other side of it, Sean Riley, surprise, surprise, 3 home runs in the matter of 24 hours between games 3 and 4. The big man hitting in the 2-hole yet again tonight, Dalton Pompey, will lead off for the Royals in the bottom of the first. The only change from that lineup from game 1, no Josh Garton. We will actually have Kyle DeGrace and his catcher tonight as well. So no Brendan Keyes. Darius Barlas fills in at second base. And Ashton Patterson in left field. He's been very, very impressive in lieu of Ethan Hammond. And we are about set to go here for a win or go home. It's been a long gone summer for the Royals bats. And Claudio Custodio, the ace, will get it started on the mound. And Kyle DeGrace, his very, very well-known partner in crime, and who's been riding shotgun with Custodio in the IBL for as long as memory serves, will catch Custodio tonight. Ethan Morrow out there at shortstop, and these guys have just been fantastic. Dalton Pompey in Hamilton the other night led off the game with a home run. Sean Riley added two more, and you think about the final score of that game, it was much closer than that final score reflected.
Close till probably the sixth or seventh inning when the Royals just got into that bullpen and just blew open the doors there, and I think collectively had a sigh of relief.
Well, yeah, it was nail-biting time for the IBL's second-best team being the Guelph Royals, and Andrew Case actually started in that game, which should be a rarity for sure. So Case threw about five innings, I believe, so he will likely be unavailable in this game if it does come down to the ninth inning. And Custodio and company have anything to say about it, they won't need Andrew Case to come into this game whatsoever. JD Williams out there in right, Ashton Patterson in left. Justin Tarasano had a heck of a game in game four, a couple RBIs as well, so he will be patrolling the one bag. Barlas, as mentioned, at two, and Malik Cullimore on the hot corner and in the cleanup spot yet again, with Kyle DeGrace behind home plate. And for the Hamilton Cardinals, again, Dennis DeBanning will lead off. Louis Jean will follow Tyler Duncan, also due up in this inning. Lane Renault batting cleanup if we get that far. And Ryan Burnside, who actually pitched in game four, back in the five hole. So a lot of guys pulling double duty, not just Claudio Custodio, but the wait is over, or just about over, as DeBanning makes his way into the box. And buckle up and get ready, this could be a classic between the Cardinals and the Royals as Custodio loosens up and looking for that prototypical first pitch strike. Swinging at it is DeBanning, and he was waiting on it, and that is a leadoff single for the Cardinals, and yet again a rarity. A rarity for the Guelph Royals and Custodio to have that happen. And Louis Jean now with a runner on has a chance to get to the Royals real quick. So don't forget, Hamilton has seen Custodio twice now. So this will be interesting to kind of decipher if they can kind of get to him and realize exactly what he'll throw in what situation and what count. Again, swinging out the first pitch. Connor Morrow makes the catch. And that is a double play. And a huge one. That was Darius Barlas, excuse me. Pardon me, I was right the first time. Morrow over at second, and him and Barlas.
Barlas is at second. Morrow's at shorts.
But he came over. Yeah. They kind of pulled the switcheroo on me. Two and four switched up, and from behind the screen and 100 feet away, look very, very similar out there in the middle infield. So two gone real quick off the Connor Morrow. The 6-3 over to Interesano double play. So Custodio, after giving off that leadoff hit, is
back to business against Mr. Tyler Duncan here.
And this should be a real good matchup, as it's been all series long. Duncan waves at one. The count is even. Not 1-1. Claudio getting encouragement from this packed Hastings plate for a ball. I won't dare try to count the amount of heads here, and they're still pouring in through the gate, but I would say it is.
It's a lot.
It's a lot. We'll go with that.
It's a lot. Let's put it that way.
And all of them.
And it's still lined up out to Division Street as far as the ticket wicket goes, too. So that's such a great scene to see here at Hastings Stadium. Thank you to the fans for supporting this team all summer long and showing it, your support in droves tonight. So great to see.
And everyone into it already. 2-2 the count. Swung on and fouled back by Duncan and right into your kitchen as it goes off our home plate camera. Duncan stays alive. Custodio quickly a strike away after giving up that leadoff hit to DeBanning. Morrow bailed him out with that 6-3 double play and looking to sit down Tyler Duncan. Swung on, and that's over to Barless at second. Over to Interessano at first. Three up, three down for Claudio Custodio and the Royals. And that is a heck of a start for the home team. We're going to take a quick break. When we come back, it'll be Dalton Pompey, Sean Riley, and Connor Morrow due up in the home half of the first inning. Dalton Pompey makes his way to the plate, and in case you missed it, he led off game four with a home run. And again, that 18 run win didn't really tell the whole story, and Pompey's leadoff home run was a huge part of what gave this Royals team momentum and the chance to win, and the reason why we're here for game five tonight. First pitch from Turcotte is a strike right down Main Street. And Sam Turcotte had this team's number through six innings pitched back in game one. And again, really the best performance we've seen against this deadly Royals lineup from an opposing pitcher in about 5 months.
Well, Jose Arias has thrown pretty well against us as well here, but I would think Turcotte's definitely had the Royals number more than Arias has.
And in that situation, that scenario, coming into Hastings Stadium in game one of a 7-2 matchup, Sam Turcotte really showed some backbone and some composure and really what he was made of in that game, and a big reason why Hamilton was able to really reel off two wins in a row. They went back home with so much confidence and momentum that you have to
be a tough play to get Pompey here.
Not in time
way down the line, and Pompey's on his way to second base, and that's where he's going to be as the ball skips out of play
into the 12th row of fans, and we'll give you the wide shot again. And Dalton Pompey doing what Dalton Pompey was brought in to do.
Single and an E2 on the throw. The Royals have got a runner in scoring position and just one batter up here.
And the hottest hitter in the Royals lineup. I mean, he changed his walk-up song in the postseason and it might have reignited some youth in the veteran, and looking to have his swan song and finish off with some gold. It's been quite a while since Sean Riley has won a championship, and nothing sweeter than finish off with another one for the IBL's all-time greatest hitter. obviously Turcotte aware of Riley, so he'll stay away from him. Riley doing a good job after early in the season chasing some pitches, has really shortened up that swing and sharpened his eye at the plate and lays off yet another one. So it's 1-0, and with Dalton Pompey in scoring position, Riley will wait for his pitch from Turcotte. High and ball two.
Got to be careful here, but he can't at the point. We can't put Riley on base here either, but he's going to definitely try to pitch around him, not get anything in Riley's wheelhouse, that's for certain.
And the other thing is, if he's pitching around too much, that could be easily a pass ball or a wild pitch, and Dalton Pompey would be at third. Riley slices one down the right field line and out of play. And yet again, not only is this our largest crowd of the summer, it's our loudest already.
No question it is, and of course.
You
probably have to request for some extra seating here if this crowds continue through the playoffs.
Standing room only, and that is an understatement here for Game 5. And if Guelph can find a way to win this game, this crowd will only grow larger and larger. Riley swings at one and pops it to shallow right field. And that is caught by the second baseman. Lane Renault, I believe, made his way over there and tracked it down. And Dalton Pompey had to stand pat, but perhaps the second most feared hitter in this lineup as of today, and definitely my favorite player, as mentioned time and time again. Connor Morrow, in case you guys weren't aware, coming to the plate, one gone, Pompey at second.
Morrow's batting .454 in the postseason. That's just...
That's it?
That's it, you know. He's just been hitting the cover off the baseball over the place.
And that bat, not the blue steel that we've seen all summer long either, so we'll see.
Unfortunately, I think blue steel got busted by somebody in one of these ball games, so...
With the amount of contact he's been making since, I don't know, June 15th or earlier, yep. It was only due time. And Morrow lays off that one, and it's 1-0. Turcotte sets. And now delivers to Burnside, and Morrow just a little early on that one. And evens the count at 1-1. Anything to right center field will be... easily a run scored with the speed of Pompey and that size of that gap between the center fielder and the right fielder out there, Tyler Duncan playing center and Dennis DeBanning in right. Anthony Buonito in right. That won a ball as Morrow laid off what looked to be a good pitch from Turcotte, but missed somewhere, and now Morrow is. Turcotte checks Pompey at second and delivers one for a strike to even the count at 2-2. Malik Collymore due up next.
Well, apparently Turcotte's been battling a blister this week as well in his pitching hand, so we'll see how well he can grip the baseball here and how long he'll go.
Yeah, it was a bit of a surprise to see him starting tonight based on what the rumors were, and he's looked pretty good so far, but that one misses to run the count full here. And now Connor Morrow with a chance to either find his way aboard by way of walk or drive Dalton Pompey at least to third base if he can make contact and find a gap. The payoff from Turcotte. Morrow swings it one. It's high and deep to left field. Doesn't look like it will have the legs. That is caught out there, and Pompey tagging. There may be a play at third. No, Jean hangs on to it as the cutoff man. Dalton Pompey advances 90 feet and is now that same distance away from opening the scoring here in the bottom of the first inning. And Malik Collymore, who is, I believe, batted cleanup in each and every game this season. And a streaky hitter is Collymore. And when he gets going, he is going. Had a great game in Game 4 and a great game in Game 2. Hit that two-run shot, but Guelph ultimately came up short in that loss. But through no fault of Collymore, who cut the lead to 1 for Hamilton in game one.
Now Turcotte and Burnside have to be very careful. They don't let anything too wild here.
And yet again, as we mentioned with Sean Riley, Malik Collymore, a similar kind of hitter. You want to dance around him, but not too much. Turcotte delivers outside, and Burnside did a great job of keeping that ball in front of him. Kudos to the catcher. Dalton Pompey was on his toes looking to take home and bring this crowd to their feet yet again, but it's 3-0 for the Royals' third baseman and cleanup hitter, Collymore. Turcotte again to the plate. That is a called strike. Yet another one.
I was waiting for him like, to be something else like Dave Steve or something that would be more appropriate today.
That Palmer one up
hits the this one, chops it through the middle here. And he's going to beat it out on an infield single, and Pompey scores, and the Royals take the lead 1-0.
That was way, way closer at first than I thought it was going to be, and that speaks to the foot speed of Malik Collymore, and Dalton Pompey trotted home as Connor Burnside went down to get the ball and cover first, and Kyle DeGrace, the catcher for the Royals, now making his way to the plate with Collymore at first, and with two out and a 1-0 lead, Malik Collymore, a guy with probably this team's best athlete, as we've mentioned many of times throughout the season, perhaps thinking about taking second and then giving DeGrace a chance to bring him in, and oh, he called his bluff. Collymore was out of the gates, but then thought better of it and retracted or returned back to first.
Well, it looked like Burnside was calling for a pitch out there too, and Collymore got wind of it, and that's why he's put the brakes on in a hurry.
A good eye by Burnside, and same as Collymore, and now he's checked over at first, back in time yet again. The count is 1-0 to DeGrace. With Justin and Tarasano loosening up on deck. J.D. Williams in the hole. That one misses as well. It's now 2-0. As DeGrace will reset, as does Turcotte. And Turcotte still with one eye on Malik Collymore over there at first, and Collymore dancing and just trying to maybe shift Turcotte's focus even more off of the bat of DeGrace, and hopefully, or hoping that Turcotte makes a mistake and lays one up for DeGrace to get a hold of, but that's in there for a strike. So now Turcotte a strike away from getting out of this with just one run scored and steps off. We'll see, as you mentioned, Neil, if Sam Turcotte's finger or hand holds up with that blister. That is the rumor. And there goes Collymore to second. Burnside the throw high and not in time. Malik Collymore, a stolen bag with two gone. And now the count is 2-2. The hands of Hastings come back together with Malik Collymore in scoring position looking to double this Royals lead in the bottom of the first. Turcotte delivers. DeGrace smacks one up the middle. That one handled easily by Louis Jean over to first base. That's out number three. Dalton Pompey provides the scoring. It's 1-0 Royals through one inning. We're off to the second. back to Hastings Stadium for inning number two. Guelph with a 1-0 lead. Thanks to Dalton Pompey, who found his way home in that bottom half of the first inning after Claudio Custodio went 1-2-3. Lane Renault swings and misses at strike number one. And nothing that Guelph can be disappointed about, but still could have been a heck of a lot worse for the Hamilton Cardinals.
No question it could have been the way we were seeing there if the guys would have had a little more patience at the plate and a bounce would have gone their way somewhere here. This account's even at 1-1.
And all things looking good for the Royals despite maybe something left to be desired in that bottom of the first. And Lane Renault backs off strike number two. Claudio Custodio showing no signs of fatigue. The tireless pitcher, infielder, designated hitter.
And he everything does it all.
Really, he does. Renault fouls that one, slices it into the parking lot, and stays alive.
I think the only position I'd be really concerned if he ever tried to play was catcher.
I feel like he also comes out and catches when he's not playing.
Yeah, he does. Yeah.
And sometimes guys will wear a mask. He does not.
Nope.
Sure-handed is Custodio. The 1-2 swung on, and another strikeout for Claudio, the king of K's in the IBL this season. Ryan Burnside, who actually did pitch in game four and is now catching yet again tonight. So another guy, as mentioned, who kind of does it all, makes his way to the batter's box for the first time this evening. And Custodio set and ready to go. DeGrace in the crouch and makes Burnside swing at strike number one. Almost aimlessly on that one. The 0-1 coming. Custodio, that one popped up to way left field and into foul territory and out of play. It's 0-2. So after Dennis DeBanning went right at Claudio to start off this game, the Cardinals having trouble making good contact. 0-2 outside.
Not a bad spot to miss there either, especially when you're up to 0-2. You don't want to throw something too good of a pitch here and let somebody back in the at-bat.
Absolutely correct, and that's the pitch that maybe Burnside wasn't expecting, but chased down low. And does that pitch on the outside as the third pitch of the at-bat make that fourth pitch even more effective after Burnside knows he has to protect the zone after Claudio wasted a pitch and Claudio got him to chase now his two quick strikeouts here in the top of the second on two batters. Anthony Buona-Yoto, who his name I will try to get correct tonight, looks at ball number one. Claudio delivers Buona-Yoto to right field. J.D. Williams underneath it. 1-2-3. Yet again, six Hamilton Cardinals to bat. Six laid to rest. We're halfway through two from Hastings Stadium. Justin and Tarasano will lead it off for the Royals in the bottom of the second, followed by J.D. Williams for a long time. Comparatively, where does this rank?
I would say it's probably up. This definitely reminds me of 1994, 1993 when the Royals were on that big run back then. And just it's so great to see it. And it's so early still. And it's, people are still lined up on Division Street here coming through the gate. It's just great to see.
And that's exactly it, is that this is just round one, as in Tarasano fouls one straight back. You know this team now has zero doubt in their mind that they can lose this game. They need, they know they need to win, and this is going to be a special, special postseason run if Guelph can get through this game here.
It's been a few years since we won the first round of a playoff series here, too, so a lot of demons could get erased tonight.
Exercised.
Yeah.
As in Tarasano is at 1-1 with Turcotte. Looks at ball number two. That was borderline, and the Royals first baseman happy to take that one. And he had a heck of a game in game four after he came in relief of Sean Riley and knocked a few of those 18 runs home and swings and cuts at one to even the count at deuces.
Well, hitting is definitely contagious, and the Royals right now have got it full blown. That's for sure. If they can keep that going here, that would bode well tonight and going forward as well.
Insanity to see the contrast between the bats in games one and two and then three and four. 2-2, and Tarasano pops it to shallow center. Underneath it, it could be trouble as a few Cardinals almost came together. I believe that was Louis Jean that came all the way over from playing in the shift. It was surprising to see how far he had to travel over. As now there's one gone, and J.D. Williams to the plate. Ball by Darius Barlas, who is filling in for Josh Garten tonight. And Josh, if you're watching, we miss you and wish you all the best and know that you are cheering this team on. As Turcotte gets a called strike with J.D. Williams showing bunt. The 0-1, Williams fouls it straight back and got a heap of it, but unfortunately, it went foul, and it's 0-2. And apparently that lineup that is down the street and around the corner can hear the crowd. It's always kind of teasing to me when you hear, like, what did I just miss? What did I just miss? And
yep.
Now it's 10 rows deep on the outfield line.
Well, that's why we got YouTube and everything else. You can watch in the line, and hope you guys are doing that. And thank you so much for watching at home or wherever you are watching tonight, the cottage, wherever, as Williams goes down on strikes here.
And if you do like what you're watching, go ahead and donate to our 50-50, buy in rather to our 50-50. All proceeds go to improving our broadcast and the equipment that seems to be more and more expensive every single day. And we appreciate your support in any way you can give it. As Turcotte gets a called strike on Darius Barlas high and on the outside part of the plate. So Sam Turcotte making quick work of the bottom half or bottom third of the Royals lineup. But mark my words, Darius Barlas to center. Underneath it is Tyler Duncan. That is a 1-2-3 inning for Turcotte and the Cardinals. We are off to three. It's 1-0 Royals. Jeremy Vaiu to lead it off for the Cardinals in what looks like it's going to be a dogfight into the third inning. It's 1-0 Guelph, and both pitchers might be in for a long night. And Sam Turcotte went against Jeffrey Nunez, who, after settling in back in game one, did a heck of a job.
He did. No,
no fault of his own, but Claudio kind of called his own number this evening and said, I'll pitch until I don't have to, and whatever happens tomorrow happens tomorrow, but I want this game, and winners always do. And after missing for a ball in the first pitch of the at-bat, evens it up with a called strike on Vaiu. It's 1-1. Vaiu fouls one straight back off to Grace.
Thank goodness he's got the hockey helmet on tonight.
This is a large, large helmet, actually.
Yes.
No, and just notice just how big it is. And comes in handy for plays like that. And it's 1-2 now, and the crowd, yet again, lively as they've been all evening long so far. The lights of Hastings Stadium, oh so bright. As Vaiu swings and misses and just add another strikeout to Claudio Custodio's total for the season and postseason. There's one gone in the top of the third. Robin Fox Pappas, who is the designated hitter tonight, now makes his way to the plate.
See if we can lower the brightness a little bit on the cameras here.
Yeah, the sun sets ever so quickly here in September, the second day of the month, and very much different than, say, July or the beginning of August. But one thing that remains the same is Claudio Custodio and his ability to throw first pitch strikes, Exhibit A right then and there. The 0-1, Claudio doesn't get the call, maybe just a bit too much inside on Fox Pappas, who laid off it. And a good eye to even the count at 1-1. That one high and clearly ball two. Fox Pappas chases one to even the count at 2-2. And I'm assuming many of these fans weren't maybe everyday fans throughout the regular season, but man, oh man, are they energetic and really into it. They know exactly how much this game means. And yet again, if Guelph can find a way to win it, it'll be really special to see what happens in round number two, which would kick off tomorrow evening. That is a called strike three that Pappas looks at. What a pitch from Claudio Custodio for out number two. That one kind of came from the outside back in. And as a righty, I don't know how you pull that off. But if you were wondering, Claudio Custodio, a much better athlete than myself.
He's a wizard, Scotty. Let's leave it at that. He's a wizard.
He's a wizard, Harry. So two down and Claudio Custodio. One Jacob Underwood out away from going 1-2-3 through the entire Cardinals lineup. That one bit inside, and Underwood did a good job of backing off the plate to sell it as a ball, and as it was called, the 1-0. Custodio, that's a strike. It's amazing to see the chemistry between DeGrace and Custodio. It's automatic between these two.
Well, exactly. They're so dialed in. They're on the same page here, and it just...
Underwood to right field. J.D. Williams won't get there in time. But man, oh man, what an effort to hold Underwood at first. That looked like it could have been extra bases all day long. But Williams did a good job to get on top of it and hold Underwood at first. With two gone, the Cardinals have their second base runner of the evening.
And Dennis DeBanning will be the batter now.
Who was the Cardinals' first base runner of the evening but was thrown out on a double play.
The former Welland Jackfish signed with the team close to the signing deadline here and has definitely been a great contributor to the Cardinals' offense since he's been here.
Yeah, definitely a much more dangerous-looking lineup, even with the absence of Justin Gideon, who coincidentally went down to Welland at the deadline. And now all of a sudden, instead of relying on Gideon all day long, the Cardinals' lineup looks a little bit more well-balanced. A strike thrown and looked at by DeBanning and Claudio. I want whatever he's having. He is just fantastic every single day. And this crowd giving him a little bit of extra oomph with the 0-2 count. Two down, swung on and missed! Claudio Custodio, my oh my, another strikeout. We are halfway through three. The Royals are up 1-0. Bottom of third, Ashton Patterson to lead it off. And after that, we'll flip the lineup over yet again. It'll be Dalton Pompey and Sean Riley. And as we mentioned so many times, the number nine hitter isn't what the number nine hitter of yesteryear used to be. Ashton Patterson, if he gets aboard, that is a whole heck of a lot of speed on the base path. And then couple that with Dalton Pompey right behind him as he looks at strike number one. It's a dangerous combination of 9-1-2 that are due up here for the Royals. Turcotte delivers. Patterson swings and tried to pull it back, but not nearly in time. It's 0-2 quickly. Turcotte on Patterson. Griffin that put his... Turcotte, oh my, what a good play to juggle that one. And never really got a clean glove on it, but made it look nice and easy, did Sam Turcotte for out number one. Dalton Pompey, who provided the one and only run of this game so far, now back to the plate. Singled his first time out and came home to bring this Royals crowd to their feet once already. Looks at one and again outside and low on the plate, but it is called a strike. It's 0-1.
He swings through that one.
It's now 0-2, and Pompey has not been very, very well blessed with a strike zone that has been favorable his way so far this season. That one well off the plate. It's 1-2. And yet again, it's always a mystery as to when you see a pitcher for a second time in the series who has the upper hand. But Pompey chops one to second. Renault on it. Over to first of AU, and that is out number two. So the Hamilton Cardinals doing a real good job here. After allowing a run in the bottom of the first, really have kind of got back to that suffocating kind of defense and pitching and infield play that frustrated the Royals oh so much through games one and two, keeping themselves in this game and just behind by one run still. Sean Riley, who exploded for three home runs between games three and four, to bat. That one off the plate and outside, 1-0.
The Turcotte's definitely not trying to get anything inside on Riley, anything in his wheelhouse. Could easily go over the fence and left here, so he's definitely trying to work him on the outside outwards.
And that one is over the plate and skied, but just off the end of the bat. Into left field, and that'll do it. Riley just chased that one maybe a bit too much. A good pitch from Turcotte. 1-2-3, go the Royals. They lead by one through three innings. Louis Jean makes his way to the plate to lead off the fourth inning, and we are only 45 minutes into this ball game, and I won't be the guy to jinx it because it's already been done up here in the booth. Flying by, Neil.
Yeah, somebody else we won't, you know, we'll just remain nameless. He's down the far end, though.
Signs our paychecks, and so we won't make too much fun of him, but his name might be Sean Fuller. He called this game a quick one, and we'll see how quickly that turns around for us as Lujan looks at ball number one, a rare first pitch ball from Claudio Custodio. And that one, a throwing ball number two and well off the plate. So much like Turcotte stayed away from Riley, Custodio dancing around Jean here. And Jean is that five-tool kind of player that if he gets on base, he could be a headache and can take a bag, and then all of a sudden.
That was a little too far inside.
Yeah, Custodio, you'd think if he was, you know, your everyday average human saying maybe perhaps showing signs of fatigue, but perhaps just lulling Jean into a false sense of comfort here. The 3-0 coming. And Jean takes a four-pitch walk to get aboard. And Tyler Duncan, who was Jean on base, is just aching to do what he's done in probably every game so far this series. And
he's definitely come through with a hit at least anyways, and usually drives in a run or two.
A few home runs to boot, and Custodio and Turcotte both have their work cut out for them. With
Turcotte's at 44 pitches. Custodio's at 38 going into this next at bat here.
That one, the fifth straight ball thrown by Claudio Custodio, which definitely the first time we've said that this season, and maybe the first time in his life. Not sure if he was wearing those glasses earlier in the evening or he put them on between innings, but there's a strike to even the count up. And with the foot speed of Jean, a ground ball would need to be almost perfect into the glove of Connor Morrow and then to probably Barless over to Interesano for the 6-4-3, but Jean with a moderate lead over at first. Custodio focused in on Duncan, and Duncan alone swings and misses. It's 1-2. Much to the delight of this Hastings crowd that, again, standing room only. They might be climbing on top of the dugouts by the time everyone gets through the gate. And if that's the case, give me a boost. 1-2, no one gone. Jean at first, Duncan at the dish. Claudio delivers, that's inside. It's 2-2.
Seemed like the release point was just slightly off on that one, and it pushed a little too far inside there.
And for the first time all season, Claudio looking a little frustrated. 2-2. There goes Jean. The pitch is inside. DeGrace can't even get a chance to make the throw. The count is full, and Louis Jean is to second and now in position to tie this game with a good base hit or a couple sack flies with no one gone. Jean represents the tying run here in the top of the fourth. We've seen Custodio get out of worse jams, so payoff pitch coming with Jean at second. Duncan swings and fouls one into the dugout. We'll do it again. And with the ability of Connor Morrow and Malik Collymore over there on the left side of the infield, it's not going to be a free pass for Jean to get to third no matter what the scenario is off the bat of Duncan. Claudio checks Louis Jean, checks him again, delivers to Duncan, called strike number three, and that's how you do it, folks. That is a massive out number one with Lane Renault now coming to the plate. Still just one gone. Louis Jean remains at second. Renault will be followed by Ryan Burnside, and Anthony Buonaiuto would be after.
I think you got it right.
I think I might have got it right. Delivers to Renault, who fouls it off the grandstands, and it's 0-1. Renault went down swinging his first time out, as did a number of Cardinals, and Claudio, again, this is the first real blip in the radar we've seen from Claudio to start this inning, but can turn around real quickly like we saw in the top of the first. John remains at second. Claudio delivers to Renault, and it's 0-2. And that island at second base appears to get further and further from home with every strike from Claudio Custodio. The 0-2. Nervous moments here as Morrow kind of bluffs his way back to second to keep Jean honest, and that one just inside and perhaps low as well. It's now 1-2, and this Hastings crowd has gone quiet, and not from lack of emotion, but perhaps just nerves. This game remains close and looks like it will for 9 consecutive innings. That one high and inside, some chin music from Claudio. And now the hands come together. A few of the Royals faithful getting everyone into it, and this place getting loud. The 2-2 swung on, and he got him swinging yet again. Lane Renault 0-for-2 with a pair of strikeouts, but more importantly, Claudio Custodio now an out away from leaving Louis Jean at second base and the lead intact. Ryan Burnside follows Renault, and this energy of this crowd continues to grow, and as does the confidence of Claudio Custodio. A first pitch strike looked at. It's 0-1 yet again. I wonder if Jean tries to get in the head of Custodio out there at second and dance around as a bit of a pitch outside to see where Jean was thinking about going, and DeGrace didn't feel a threat, so Jean returns to second base. It's 1-1. Let's see if Connor Moore goes back to second to cover. That one's a strike, and my oh my, no surprise. The struggles and the frustration, perhaps very short-lived if this next pitch is what you think it'll be. Hands together, feet to the ground. Butts out of seats, delivers to first base in Tarasano with an easy ground ball. And that is out number 3. Louis Jean left at second base. The Royals with their lead intact. We're halfway through 4 innings at Hastings Stadium. We'll be back after this. Connor Morrow to get it going in the bottom of the fourth, and the Royals desperate for some runs and some insurance here, and this might be the trio to do it. Morrow, Collymore, and DeGrace all do up here in the bottom of the fourth, but Sam Turcotte appears to be dialed in just like Claudio Custodio. What a top of the fourth after a leadoff base hit and a double. All of a sudden, it was three up, three down, and Claudio got out of it with almost an overwhelming amount of ease.
Custodio activated beast mode, that's for sure, and just said, yeah, you ain't getting anybody else, anything else this inning.
Yeah, it was a first-pitch walk, a four-pitch walk.
Yep.
Our first at-bat walk, leadoff walk, as I find my words. And Connor Morrow swings at the 1-0 and slices it well out of play into the stands. And as we were mentioning between innings, a number of these fans are young children, and we have that marathon around the bases in the fifth inning, and it might take forever and a day with the amount of children that will want to be a part of that.
Well, a couple weeks ago when we were playing the Brantford Red Sox in the fifth inning, they were actually cheering against the Royals. They were chanting for the pitcher to strike him out so they could go run the bases.
That's as believable as can be. I've heard a lot of them ask, when are we running the bases? Can I go now? No, you may not. They 2-1 comes in there to even the count at 2-2.
I think the Royals scored six runs that inning or something, and it was just like Jeff McLeod was up for the second or third time that inning, and it was just, I think it was a 28-minute inning, actually. I don't blame them for being a little
antsy, yeah. as we sometimes get up here as well for a 28-minute inning, and we are now full in the count. Morrow and Turcotte, payoff coming. Excuse me, that is not a ball four. That is a 3-2 count. I hit the button overzealously. Count's full, and Morrow will walk his way to first base. Our scoreboard having a little bit of mind of its own. And now, Malik Collymore with a runner aboard will look to build on this 1-0 lead for the Royals, and still a lineup from what I've been being texted from friends, family, and otherwise outside of this ballpark. And I don't think anyone can ignore the crowd here. And we apologize if you live in the neighborhood and are trying to get some sleep tonight, but it's Friday. Get over it.
It's Friday.
It's playoff time.
We'll send you some tickets tomorrow, honest. We will.
Just get here early. And yes, game one, if Guelph can find a way to hold on to this lead and win this game, we'll be right back here in 24 hours. Turcotte, the 1-0. Morrow looking to take second. There'll be a play. And unfortunately, Lane Renault for the Cardinals wasn't able to hang on to it. That might have been a very hard call to make, but the ball came loose, and Connor Morrow finds his way to second base. The count is 1-1 to Malik Collymore, who swung almost defensively to kind of slow up Ryan Burnside behind home plate to give Connor Morrow an extra split second or two to take that bag, and it worked out perfectly. Collymore fouls that one off, and 1-2, no one gone. Morrow at second. His baseball IQ is off the charts, so much like pitchers and catchers, Morrow at shortstop defensively knows everything about how to read a pitcher's first move, so we'll see if he decides to take third here. Collymore up the middle, could be trouble. Louis Jean dives, but can't get the ball. Connor Morrow slipped and held up, and that could have been an easy second run. Not quite sure what happened, but Morrow playing it safe is now at third with no one gone, and Kyle DeGrace with a chance to drive him in.
Well, his first movement when he got to the bag at third was to stop, and it's kind of hard to crank the engine back up when you stop it on a dime there, so probably was the wise choice as the ball was then quickly thrown into the infield.
And the silver lining is he got up and with no injury, because that's kind of a nightmare situation, especially for your middle infielder, and really the wise man of that infield is Connor Morrow, and nonetheless, still 90 feet away from home with no one gone, and Kyle DeGrace at that. Malik Collymore probably looking to take second here. There he goes. DeGrace holds off. The throw from Burnside off the target.
Ball one and a stolen base.
So it's 1-0, runners at second and third. And I wonder if there's been a bit of a tip of the cap for the Royals base runners and Ryan Burnside behind home plate.
Burnside blocks that one wisely there and definitely just saved a run.
And to be honest, neither of those throws. Excuse me, it is now 1-1. It's now 1-2. One and two, and yeah, we are confirmed from the home plate umpire. DeGrace waves at one and goes down swinging. There's one gone now. Runners still at second and third, and Justin Terrasano a fly ball away from doubling his team's lead.
Infield is still in on the inside and the edge of the grass here. They got to knock it down and prevent a run from going home here.
And look at that gap between Tyler Duncan in center.
If Terrasano hits it in one of his favorite spots here,
yeah,
he's going to clear the bases.
And Anthony Bonaiuto in right, that gap has to be at least 60, 70, maybe more feet. I'm not much of a architect, or my eyes don't work all that great. As Terrasano looks at ball one, that is a mile between the right fielder and the center fielder for Hamilton, and Terrasano as a lefty.
If Terrasano can groove it down the line, he's going to definitely score the runs for sure here.
And that one is a called strike, and not sure where. And the huge crowd at Hastings seems to agree. It's now 1-1. And if Turcotte can find his way out of this jam, that would be do wonders for Hamilton. But that's hit high! That's hit deep to right! And that ball! See ya! Justin Terrasano! A three-run shot! And Guelph, get on your feet! Neil, it was just a matter of time for Juicy. And man, oh man. Couldn't happen for a better guy. He got a hold of that baseball. And is overjoyed coming home. And look at the Royals dugout. That meant so much to this baseball team. That could have been a momentum shift if Guelph was able to, or not able to score a run. I was going to say if they were able to leave more runners stranded, which I don't think there's enough fingers and toes up here to see what they've done all season long. That swings things huge for the Royals now with a 4-0 lead as Williams looks at ball number one.
Activity is definitely going in the Hamilton Cardinals bullpen now. Like, looks like it might be Jose Fernandez down there. Can't exactly see over the fence here because it's a tad too dark. We don't have the luxury of a bullpen cam right now. But
if you buy into the 50-50 online,
exactly,
you can see that next summer. And with this Royals team that looks poised to, we would love to see more and more of you buy into the 50-50 as Turcotte kind of misses that ball. It's 1-2. So if it is Fernandez warming up down there in the bullpen, how much more does that home run from Terrasano mean for the 4-0 lead? Williams chases one and it's 1-2 now, or that is a strikeout, excuse me, as I count my fingers. And Darius Barlas now with two gone comes to the plate, and the damage has already been done for the Royals thanks to that three-run shot from Terrasano. And Sam Turcotte will look just to try to minimize it now, but Darius Barlas, always dangerous, looks at one about forehead high for ball number one. That one dances back in over the outside part of the plate. It's 1-1. Did I burst your eardrum with a home run call?
No, I'm okay right now. We're all right.
I can see your body language and demeanor have changed. I can hear you.
I can definitely hear you in my ears, that's for sure.
Yeah, so can I. Imagine being me. It's 1-2, Barlas and Turcotte. Go at it again. Barlas fouls it straight back. And Sam Turcotte, I mean, I'm not sure what the idea was with that Interesano pitch, but he's done a great job otherwise. It's just been a pitcher's duel, and Interesano might be the difference maker here.
Juicy when he's on. He hits right into that exact spot where he hit it right tonight, just over above the Sleeman sign. That's his spot. That's what I've called it his spot for many years, and it's just that's his spot.
And it's one of the deepest parts of the ballpark, which is comical. That ball, it was a moonshot, and I really – were we on the wide shot for the home run?
Yeah, I think we were. So
him and Vinny can watch it back and be very, very proud and enjoy that one. As Interesano, a 31-year-old, likely with some gas left in the tank, but who knows what the future holds
for him. Maiden, thank you so much.
Chopped first. Over to Turcotte at covering and makes the reach and grab and records out number three by tapping the first base bag, but not before Justin Interesano added three more runs for the Royals' lead. It's 4-0. Off to the fifth we go.
Top of the fifth inning here at Hastings Stadium. I'm Neil Srivastava. Thank you so much for hanging out with us on your Friday night. The Royals up 4-0 here in Game 5 of the quarterfinal series. As Anthony Bonanuto is the batter. Takes the first pitch from Custodio for ball number one. Royals on the home run by Justin Interesano got themselves a little more breathing room, and I think the crowd collectively took a sigh of relief here. Pitch from Custodio's in there for a strike. Evens the count at 1-1. And a lot of Welland Jackfish fans watching with eager anticipation here. They're all over us on social media right now. And that's okay. 1-2 pitch on its way from Custodio. Misses high. Evens the count at 2-2. If the Cardinals win this series, they'll travel to London to take on the Majors. If the Royals win, they host the Welland Jackfish tomorrow night here at 7:30 p.m. So this one hits him on the inside. And the Cardinals have got the leadoff man aboard here.
The first baseman, Jeremy Vallou.
Jeremy Vallou now the batter. The 0-for-1 with a strikeout last time. He's batting 454 in the series. He takes strike one here. Custodio gets the strike in there, and the count is 0-2 to Vallou. Hastings crowd behind Custodio once again. 1-2 pitches, swung on and missed. And Vallou goes down on the strikeouts for the second time tonight. Royals have one away here as Robin Fox Pappas now the batter, the designated hitter. He struck out in this third inning, his first time through. Fox Pappas batting 222 in the postseason. Custodio's first pitch to Pappas is in there for a strike, and his count is 0-1. Strike two called here as Custodio's ahead of the count at 0-2. Custodio takes a quick look around the base pass, assesses his challenge here. 0-2 pitch on its way. Driven to right field fairly deep. Williams gives this one chase down the right field line, and it's going to go out of play as he knocked over a fan almost. As a young kid goes down the line and grabs the baseball.
What an effort from JD on that play, and the dust kind of settled. Sorry we didn't have the wide shot open for you, but it was well out of frame either way. And running down to the main level, the lineup for the concession stand, Neil, is from concession all the way to the edge of the grandstand.
Oh, goodness.
We have all hands on deck, our volunteers, and are very much being put to the test tonight. Some have gone out to grab more supplies and hot dogs and freezies and beer alike. So this crowd is happy to be here and hungry.
People got to eat.
People got to eat.
Oh. Custodio misses inside again.
I feel like Fox Pappas was crowding the plate just a little bit there, so it might have looked a little bit more inside on him than it perhaps was, but nonetheless, it's 2-2. Custodio shakes off to Grace just once, and now they're ready to do it again. That one swung on and missed. Yet another strikeout for Claudio Custodio. And I'm going to ask you, do you know what the record for strikeouts is in the postseason?
I don't, but I'm going to say it's probably 17 or 18. I think it's probably by Ron Stead again. I wouldn't be surprised.
17 or 18 in an entire playoff run?
Well, in a game, actually. But
I was going to say, okay, that makes more sense.
Yeah.
I don't think Claudio is going to get to that number tonight based on kind of the hectic schedule that this team in this league has to face just based on Mother Nature and other things alike. And no matter what happens the rest of this game, round two will start tomorrow night, whether that's Hamilton in London or Welland here. Another strike called. It's 0-2. Man at first. And this crowd is loving it. We will let them do the talking. It's 1-2, and I perhaps ran into myself there, so we'll see if they can do it for us one more time. It's 1-2. Here are the hands.
He fouls that one off the end of the bat there and stays alive.
That one looked like it might have been stayed fair, but did it bounce off the plate first?
I think it bounced off the – actually, they hit the player, actually, on the swing, so.
Yeah, the way it dribbled, it must have, right? So,
yeah.
Or DeGrace, it might have hit DeGrace as he checks himself, and Jacob Underwood went back to make sure that DeGrace was no worse for wear, as some of those can hit you in a place that you don't want to be hit all that often.
No, exactly, you know. You down there. The athletic support can only hold, only support so much there.
1-2 coming. Swung on and add another one to the total. Jacob Underwood shakes his head and walks back to the dugout. Claudio Custodio smiles all the way to the bank. We are halfway through five innings. Guelph 4, Hamilton no score. Ashton Patterson will lead off the bottom of the fifth. Jose Fernandez, the hard-throwing lefty, into the game for the Cardinals. So Sam Turcotte goes four innings and gives up four runs. Fernandez, who came in game one and really put the boots to the Royals in the ninth inning and shut them down on three straight strikeouts, will look to do the same. He throws gas and that, there it is on display for strike number one. Patterson will likely just try to pray for one here and get a hold of something in the infield. And that is...
That is nasty.
Yes. That is a young Royal and a former Blue Jay prospect and Jose Fernandez going head-to-head. And
the young man has a lot to learn after that pitch.
Good luck. Make him miss. That one's high, and that's maybe the method to finding a way around Jose Fernandez.
Here. We knew it was just a matter of time before Fernandez made another appearance in this contest here, and it was just...
There were rumblings of him perhaps starting this game if it came down to it, but Turcotte was able to go, and that is looked at and a called strike number three, one gone. And this matchup might be one of those that's real fun to watch. Both of these players in the Jays system at one point, and Pompey switches to the other side of the plate. The former Jay that leads off now for the Royals, a switch hitter, and now bats righty against the lefty Fernandez. That one high and misses. That's a ball. And Dalton has really put on display his very vast ability at the plate, whether it's taking a walk or hitting the ball out of the park or just finding a way to turn a single into a double or even do a triple sometimes. And if he doesn't do that, he's happy to steal a bag or two when he's on the base path. So a very, very dangerous leadoff man.
Well, Wednesday night in Hamilton, he hit one off the fence in center field that I thought, you know, he's going to be a double, but he legged it out so fast. If the outfielders didn't get it back in, he probably would have ended inside the Parker.
That one misses, and that's the thing is Pompey has such confidence when he's on the base path that there's no hesitation of, oh, should I not? It's that split-second decision that can sometimes hang you up. Dalton doesn't have that. He just knows exactly where he's going every single time. It's 2-1. Fernandez to Pompey. Pompey slices one straight back, and you always know that they just missed it when they look at the bat that way, and Pompey maybe just a split second late, which is an impressive feat considering the speed of Fernandez's old number one, as they say. And be interesting to see if he switches it up with anything. I think it's been fastball all day long, and that is a strike three called. Nobody likes it on the Royals side of it, but that's out number two.
Number 33, Sean Riley.
And Sean Riley now to the plate, and back in game one, it was a one-run game, and Fernandez came and sat down Riley, but he just missed one, too. And speaking to him between that game and now, said that he just missed it. He fouled it straight back, and it hit the grandstand, and it was one that he would love to have back. But now with a 4-0 lead, two gone. Fernandez to Riley for the first time this evening. High for ball number one. One-oh coming. Fernandez to Riley again. Swung on, and that's the swing that Riley wanted. But maybe just a bit mistimed. It's 1-1. This crowd's still nervous. 4-0 is never a safe lead in this game. 1-1 coming. Riley takes it inside, and it's now 2-1.
Well, Fernandez will try to tempt Riley to hit something he doesn't want to swing at here, but he's definitely gonna, he's not afraid to throw it inside to Riley, which is really unheard of here. He goes back outside on that one to even the count at 2-2.
Yeah, I don't think Fernandez is all that intimidated by Riley as much as, say, any other pitcher would be normally.
Oh, exactly, you know, because Fernandez probably doesn't know Riley's reputation and everything else. His name doesn't just, oh, it's another guy out there.
Sean Riley would like to make sure he remembers his name here. That one misses, and he gets a favorable call to Riley. The count runs full. And that is a very good point, Neil. Something that didn't really occur to me is that Fernandez may or may not really be familiar with Riley and his reputation, and or nor care.
Yep.
Payoff coming. Riley swings and misses, and Jose gets the best of Riley yet again. Another strikeout for Fernandez in relief here for the Cardinals, who have a lot of work to do. They're down 4-0 through five innings.
Well, of course, we'll mute the microphone and leave the kids letting them run the bases here. There's a lot of kids tonight.
Claudio Custodio remains in the game for the moment. Dennis DeBanning back to the plate for his third trip this evening. Had a leadoff single to start this ball game and then went down swinging his second time up. This will be the third time he faces Custodio tonight, so we'll see if he has a bit of a book on him now and swings and misses at strike number one. And there, I believe, may be rumblings of action out in the Guelph bullpen as we have time called by the second base umpire.
Something on the field by the looks of it. Somebody dropped something.
One of those darn kids. Another record high tonight. Running around the bases. We expected it to be a large herd of children, and it was. And they had a lot of fun doing it, and we had fun watching. The 0-1 swung on. It's 0-2.
Jay Banning batting 117 in the postseason. He's 1-for-2, as you mentioned, Scotty. He's singled in the first and struck out in the third, like you mentioned. But, yes, they want to, Cardinals want to get back into this game. It's got to start with this top of the order here.
And another strikeout swinging for Dennis DeBanning and another K for Claudio Custodio. Louis Jean now will look to start the fire for the Cardinals and chip away. And it always starts with one as Jean makes his way to the plate. It's 0-for-1, grounded into a double play, and then walked his second time out and was left stranded at second back in the fourth inning when it was just 1-0. And Jean represented the tying run with no one out, and then Claudio found a way to go 1-2-3 after Jean, who swings and misses at the first pitch he sees in this at-bat. It's 0-1 with one down. Custodio sets, deals, and Jean looked like he may have attempted a swing at that. Am I mistaken?
He tried to swing at it, but it hit him off the elbow, so he's taking his way down to first.
Didn't seem to be much of a discussion otherwise, so Jean hit by pitch. He's now 0-for-1 with two walks, one the hard way. Tyler Duncan now, and this is the thing about a 4-0 lead, is that Tyler Duncan, an oh-so-dangerous hitter, can really, really change the complexion of this 4-0 game with some contact and some power that the Cardinals center fielder possesses. And has
to say he opened my eyes this postseason is an understatement. Just I didn't realize what kind of numbers this kid was capable of coming into this series.
Extremely impressive is Tyler Duncan, the Toronto native, and the Hamilton Cardinals center fielder looks at a called strike to start his third at-bat of the evening. That being said, Duncan quiet so far tonight at the plate, 0-for-2 with a strikeout, grounded out his first time out, and with Louis Jean at first, he's behind 0-1 in the count to Claudio. That sails one to left field. Malik Collymore out of play. He had a beat on it, but just
there's a
little
pile up
too
trying
far
to go after the baseball down there.
And that's the issue with so many fans here. It almost becomes impossible to track those balls into foul territory as the hands of Hastings come together. It's 0-2 between Claudio and Tyler Duncan. One down, top of six, 4-0 Royals for the moment. Sean takes off, Duncan swings, and is called out on strikes. So that's two outs now. As there was a bit of a discussion at home plate, but Tyler Duncan will make his way back to the dugout. Louis Jean makes his way to second base. And Claudio Custodio, an out away from having another six innings under his belt. Neil, you said he came into this inning with 75 pitches already. Pretty impressive for a guy who pitched just a few nights ago and has played every game since one way or another. No, tireless effort.
It's hard to keep him out of the lineup, and Dino Romel has tried many times, but just not successful right now.
And how do you when he continues to deliver and perform the way he has?
Well, exactly. It's hard to hard to rationalize trying to keep him off the lineup too, but it's just at the same time, you got guys playing positions and everything else. We had some injuries and some guys having to go back to school. Ethan Hammond's out of the lineup now. He's back at school, so he can't play here anymore. He'd wreck his NCAA eligibility if he was to play in one of these games. So we don't want that to happen either.
Yeah, and the bullpen does get thin as well with that same scenario with so many of every team's pitchers having other commitments late into the summer, and as the calendar flipped to September, things changed real quick. It's 0-2, two down, and we'll let the fans call this one. The appeal down to first, and it looked a little high, absolutely, but
I don't think his hands broke the plane at all. No. There's just, he laid off.
Hopeful Hastings crowd.
You can't blame them there either. Just, you know, they're cheering for their guys. They're just trying to get their pitcher off the hill here again.
Lane Renault, who you spoke about in game one, I believe. Yeah, back in game one, you were speaking about how much Lane Renault impressed you as well. So this Hamilton team, not for nothing. The record may not reflect it, but some real talent.
I know, and that's a credit to Jeff Lonsberry and his staff. They got this team going in the right direction after a really rough start. They had the really tough schedule, too, to start the season. A lot of games against the London Majors, Welland Jackfish, the Guelph Royals. It's just hard to get momentum when you're playing against the top team almost every second night.
As the runner was off with the pitch, but Renault just a little ahead of Custodio, who is stuck at 2-2 with Lane Renault. And I don't think that any team, I don't think the Royals expected to ever have that much shock and awe being down 0-2 in the first round. I think it was really stunned them, and thankfully it kind of woke them up for games 3 and 4, and another doozy here tonight. We'll do the 2-2 again. Claudio delivers. It's in the dirt. Count is full. Hastings crowd, the Royals loyals, as I'm trying to get that freeze going, trying to point it. Come together now, hoping for another Claudio Custodio strikeout. That one back up the middle. Barless can't get to it. And Hamilton is on the board. A two-out single and an RBI for Lane Renault as Louis Jean breaks the goose egg for the Cardinals, and all of a sudden, it's a three-run ball game.
And you definitely got to keep an eye on Custodio here as far as pitch count and just even overall health right now. He's done everything he can right here. The bullpen looks like it's getting loose in a hurry here too. So
a number of them up and moving around, and I mean, unfortunately, had Claudio got the best of Renault in that at bat, it would be in and over and in a much different situation. But now, Lane Renault at first, it's a 4-1 ball game, and the Cardinals have a hope. Renault off to second, and DeGrace tries to frame one, and not even a throw. As Ryan Burnside is all even with Custodio at 1-1. That one called a ball, and also advance Renault to second. 1-1, two gone. That one also doesn't get the call. It's 2-1.
Well, you got to be careful with Custodio not overthrowing in this situation either. You don't want to try to blast it past somebody here.
Again, it's not even close to over here in the top of the sixth inning. That one's high, and it's 3-1. Andrew Case, who went deep into the ball game back in game 4, definitely not one of those Royals who's loosening up, but sure, Dino Rommel would love to have Case in this scenario, and unfortunately, he will not be one of the deployable relievers in this game. That one chopped by Burnside, foul. It's now full, 3-2, two gone. Rommel at second, and Claudio Custodio hoping that this may be his last pitch of the evening, as does everyone here in the Hastings crowd that every time I look around seems to get larger and larger. Payoff swung on, and DeGrace dropped it, and Terrasano at first makes the play, and the Royals get out of it, but not before the Hamilton Cardinals put one on the board. It's 4-1, halfway through six innings from Hastings Stadium. Dory Torres into the game, so Jose Fernandez just one inning of work, and my oh my, is that detrimental to the Hamilton Cardinals, because Guelph, and both times they saw him, couldn't even come close to touching Fernandez. Now Torres into the game, and no disrespect to Dory, but Guelph has a real chance to add to this 4-1 lead after, oh, Connor Morrow, what a hit! What an infield hit! Small ball by definition.
That is exactly what happened there. And, you know, it's just maybe Fernandez was that little brief, you know, pause that the Cardinals needed to say, okay, let's take our catch our breath. We've got a guy that's going to go out there and throw strikes against their the top of their order here. Give them a chance to win it.
And our in-house 50-50 total is $709, which is
great. The Boy Scouts and everybody else, thank you so much for participating tonight, and don't forget to grab the online one as well. Go to Guelph5050.com and buy your tickets. Third baseman does not see it, and it's going to drop in. Foul.
So yet another lucky break for Malik Collymore and the Guelph Royals in this ball game. As that, I'm not sure if it was the lights. I assume it had to be the lights. It was lost in the sky, and it's 0-1. Collymore will reset with Morrow at first. And
Collymore 2-for-2 tonight. Pair of stolen bases as well, two singles, an RBI, and a run scored.
Not not a bad evening so far, and another shot here to make it a perfect 3-for-3. And a fan encourages Colley Moore to go to the Shoeless Joe sign, which is out there pretty much in the opposite side of the field as Justin Tarasano hit over the Sleeman sign. And the Shoeless Joe sign equally as far away from home, perhaps just a little bit further. Colley Moore definitely capable of doing that. It's 0-2 on him, though, and that ball low as Morrow was thinking about swiping one, but Burnside saw it coming and called his bluff and had Morrow go back to first, and Colley Moore went down and strikes, so it's one gone, with Morrow at first, and Kyle DeGrace to the plate.
DeGrace 0-for-2 in the contest. See if this one, the shortstop takes the bounce right to the glove, unfortunately, and they're going to double him off there.
That looked like it had a chance to get through, but a great play. 5-4-3, double play, and that brings the inning to a close. We're off to the 7th, 4-1 Guelph. Top of the seventh inning at Hastings Stadium. Jeffrey Nunez in relief for Claudio Custodio. Brendan Keyes comes in to cover for Kyle DeGrace behind home plate. Guelph with that 4-1 lead. Nunez first pitch is inside for a ball. He had a heck of an outing in his first playoff appearance back in game one. Took him a while to settle in, but only gave up 2 runs and really, really did a great job as the game went on, as that is a hit to get the seventh inning started from the leadoff man, Anthony Juan Ayuto. I am going to somehow try to get that right twice in a row. I apologize, Anthony. He is aboard at first, and now Jeremy Vayu will follow, and Robin Fox Pappas on deck. Again, just a 3-run lead for the Royals, so don't go anywhere. Fouled straight back into the netting, and it's 0-1. Nervous moments here, and again, this crowd has gone silent. Juanito at first. Was looking like maybe getting a little greedy with that lead. We'll see if Nunez is aware of that. And that's a called strike number two. And even myself, I'm getting a loss for words and getting a little tongue-tied and nervous, which is a rarity now.
Oh. There's not much. We can't control the pace up here. We can't throw the pitch for them and everything else. We just have to sit back and try to make sense of what's going on in the field as much as possible here.
One and two as Nunez missed. And he sets up outside Nunez. And he seemed to be on the same page, but now it's two and two. That one could have been trouble if Keys didn't hang on to it, but thankfully for the Royals and all the home team fans, all thousands of them, Keys did hang on to it. The 2-2 coming outside and low. Count's full, no one gone, one man on. And this game seems a lot less out of reach at the moment. Swung on and missed. Jeffrey Nunez sits him down. Jeremy Vayu chased one off the plate, and interestingly enough, Nunez went outside, 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 and Vayu still bit on that last pitch, and thankfully for Nunez and Keys and the rest of the Royals, it's out number one, Robin Fox Pappas now. Juanito at first still. That one again low and off the plate. Much different pace as well from the Claudio Custodio innings from Nunez right away. 1-0. Swung on by Pappas to even the count at 1-1.
Jeffrey just has to come out here and just throw strikes and get ground balls, and he'd be fine.
Time called as Nunez was set to deliver, and absolutely, and it will keep the pace and the momentum going and get this crowd back into it, because, again, they've really seemed like now sitting on the edge of their seats but almost walking on eggshells. Swung on by Fox Pappas yet again and missed on yet again. It's 1-2. Like Neil just mentioned, Nunez has to get strikes either way they come. That one off. The play doesn't get the call. And
strike zone has definitely changed in this last half inning or so. Which happens. It's around this time of night anyways.
Absolutely it does. 2-2. That one back up the middle. Can Morrow get there? It's off the bag. And what a play. Called safe at second. And my goodness, it was a
tough play.
Yeah, very tough play, and I don't know about that one, but we're way far away. And
number five, Jacob Underwood.
Jacob Underwood with two men on has a chance to change this ball game completely as he represents the tying run.
Official scorer feeling a little generous on there, awarded the base hit as it clanked off the base. It's a tough play for Morrow. They wouldn't have had to play anyways. If he wasn't standing there, it would have gone in any outfield anyways.
Yeah, it might have been even worse had it not gone off the base, but nonetheless, a great play to go backhand over to Barless. And unfortunately, I couldn't get the runner in time, and that one called a ball inside on that's a called strike on Jacob Underwood. Counts now even. One one coming, one out, two on. That one misses. It's 2-1, and Nunez having trouble getting strikes called.
And the pace might have got that one if Keys was able to hold on to that one, but unfortunately it dropped in front of the plate there, so hard to get the umpire's call on that one.
Never going to get that call on that one. It's 3-1, and Nunez needs to find a way. 2-1 and a 3-1 count. Jacob Underwood at the plate and represents the tying run. And that is a walk, and it's well off the plate. Nunez just needs to settle in at this point. Bases are now loaded with one out, and there will be a conference on the mound for the Royals. We did see this back in game one, just a bit of early game jitters. Obviously, it was the first inning and the first part of the game, but nonetheless, for Jeffrey Nunez, this is exactly the same scenario. So settling in is just something he'll have to do. And if Saturday night's game one was any sort of indication, he will do just that. And the entire infield, along with Dino Rommel, came over just to maybe
help
them.
Pep talk.
Absolutely.
Another little breath of air. Say, hey, take a breath here and relax. You got this. You got the defense behind you here.
And you're a ground ball away from getting out of here.
Yep. And it was probably just another conversation. Okay, where are we going on this play? If he hits it, where are we going?
Throwing home unless it's on the ground tomorrow, my assumption would be.
You're probably accurate there as far as that goes.
Top of the order again. That's a called strike.
Dennis Day Banning's he's 1-for-2. He's singled in the first inning and struck out swinging both times since.
1-for-3.
Oh, sorry, 1-for-3, yes.
And another strike thrown by Nunez. And not to be premature, but man, oh man, things change quickly. I'm correcting you on counts. And hands come together and the energy's all of a sudden back in this building. And Banning wisely calls time as this crowd getting right back into it. 0-2, one gone, bases loaded. 4-1 game. Swung on and missed Jeffrey Nunez, a three-pitch strikeout. How is that for a bounce back?
That's a huge out right now as far as the Royals are concerned. And for Nunez, that might be a shot the Army needs here as he's going to have to face Luis Jean now, the shortstop.
John, who's ever even more eccentric than myself, full of energy, and if you watch him in the batter's box, he does not stop moving. It's almost like there's a whole hive of bees around him sometimes. He's just, as seen here, as he loosens up, but pay attention to it throughout the at-bat. He is always on the go. Bases loaded, now two out, which is huge because a fly ball will not be able to cash in a run for the Cardinals. Nunez delivers. Jean to right field. Williams tracking it. And can't make the catch. That'll fall in as Williams goes down. That'll score two. And this game is tied as Louis Jean is into third. And the few Cardinals fans in this building are overjoyed, and Tyler Duncan, with two gone, has Louis Jean 90 feet from giving his team the lead.
The right fielder, number 55, Tyler Duncan.
We expected a good ball game, and man, oh man, it looks like we're gonna get just that here. Two gone in the top of the seventh inning. Duncan at the plate, Jean at third. Off the plate, and we'll see if Nunez can keep his composure.
Not sure what happened to Williams. I don't know if he thought he was running into the wall there. He tried to pull up on it or just slipped on the warning track for the edge of the grass.
Yeah, it didn't look like much of a leap, but it was a long way to run. So I'm not quite sure if it was just kind of a layout or it was a long way away from us too. So can't really be sure, but now Nunez is now behind the count 2-0, and Duncan looking his chops. Swings and misses. It's 2-1. Well, we wanted a classic Neil, and every single one in attendance is pretty much in for that. 2-2 the count after Duncan swings at another one with no success. Lane Renault will follow Duncan, unless, of course, Nunez use this momentum from the Hastings crowd to sit down Duncan. Off the plate, he's tried to frame it. The count is full. As mentioned, the Royals bullpen is thin, much like the rest of the league's bullpens, and
Jeff McLeod actually came into the game in game four, so anything is possible. Swung on and missed, Jeffrey Nunez. Leaves Louis Jean stranded at third, and I think Jean is upset with himself. He may have had a chance to come home on that play, and although he cashed in three runs and tied the game, still looks a little frustrated. We have a brand new ball game halfway through seven. Justin and Tarasano will lead it off here in a tied ball game in the bottom of the seventh inning. And pretty much as advertised, these two teams will not roll over and say die. Hamilton had that 2-0 lead in a best of five before Guelph came out and scored 34 runs between games three and four. And had a 4-0 lead here on home field in front of a huge crowd that has been on their side and ever so boisterous about that all night long. And then Hamilton, one run in the sixth and then three more in the top of the seventh to tie the game. Louis Jean with a bases clearing triple that perhaps could have been more, but was left stranded at third afterward. This game remains tied. And Tarasano, who gave Guelph that 4-0 lead with a three run shot earlier in the game, is behind 1-2. He is 1-for-2 as well. Flew out his first time up in the first second, and then that moonshot in the fourth. 1-2 coming. Torres and Interesano will do it again as Interesano pulls that into the Hamilton dugout.
If you're the Guelph Royals here, you just got to get some base runners. You got to calm yourselves at the plate and everything else. You just put the top of the inning behind you here. So now it's nothing here in the seventh inning, guys. You have two innings to win.
Yeah, you can't treat it like you've lost. And you're still tied, and Interesano swings at one looking to emulate what he did in the fourth, but to no avail on Torres. J.D. Williams, who has been quiet at the plate so far this evening. And a optimist would say he's just due. Two strikeouts swinging, 0-for-2. And Williams, a very, very deployable hitter, and in this scenario, could cause damage. Takes one inside, it's 1-0. A 1-0 from Torres to Williams. Also inside and off the plate, 2-0. Torres delivers, Williams swings and pops, flares one to right. And that catch is made for out number two. And nervous moments yet again.
Second baseman number four, Darius Barless.
Making his way back to the dish. He's also 0-for-2. Ashton Patterson would follow, who is also 0-for-2. So Guelph looking for some production and energy from the bottom third of that lineup before we go back to the top of it. Following Patterson, Barless pumps one but misses strike one.
Barless flew out to center field and grounded out 3-1 in the fourth here.
Doesn't get the call, and consistency is key for a home plate umpire, and much like Jeffrey Nunez experienced, Dory Torres is getting the same kind of experience right about now. Time called. If Barless can flare one to shallow right center, he'll get a board. That's a strike called on the upper outside corner, and fans and volunteer umpires, not a big fan. 1-2. That one popped to right center, but high. Lots of time for Duncan to get underneath that and makes the catch for out number three. Guelph goes 1-2-3. Through seven innings, and it's a tie ball game from Hastings Stadium.
Lane Renault will get the top of the eighth underway. Jeffrey Nunez remains in the game. Some action in the Royals bullpen, but not quite sure who. And in a tie ball game, Jeffrey Nunez will need to find some sort of middle ground compared to his last inning of work. Some good strikeouts and then some real difficult at-bats. Nunez looking to get things started with a first pitch strike on Renault, and that'll do it. 0-1. Tense moments here in Hastings still. 0-1 coming, that's over the play for a strike. What a pitch from Nunez, and as expected appears to now, after an inning of work under his belt, appear to be much more confident. Swung on, and that's a three pitch strikeout from Nunez on Renault, and that'll get the energy back in this building. Ryan Burnside, the catcher, back to the plate. Burnside is 0-for-3. A pair of strikeouts in the game. And after pitching in game four, a guy with a lot to think about. Manning home plate defensively for the Cardinals tonight. That's another strike from Jeffrey Nunez. Looks like a different pitcher so far here in the top of the eighth inning. Fouled off, but it's 0-2. Burnside will be followed by the right fielder, Anthony Buonaiuto. That one fouled, and Burnside stays alive.
0-2, the count remains. Hastings hopefuls bring their hands together, swung on, back-to-back strikeouts, Jeffrey Nunez. So now, Anthony Buonaiuto will look to find a way to catch up to Nunez and his gas that he's been throwing here in the eighth inning. Another first pitch strike, and the embodiment of Claudio Custodio on the mound in the form of Jeffrey Nunez in this eighth inning so far. That one popped up and high, and someone's got to call it. Connor Morrow can't make the play. Nunez backed off, and that is just in no man's land. And not quite sure. It was a you got it, you got it, you got it situation. And
nobody got it, unfortunately, and that's just going to be an infield single.
Buonaiuto now aboard, and Jeremy Velu for the chance to give his team their first lead of this ball game after some fortune and misfortune, depending on what side of it you're on. And that infield fly ball that found its way to God's green earth. That one, a strike thrown again. And it's 0-1. That one gets away from Keys, and Buonaiuto on his way to second.
They scored a wild pitch.
Well off the plate and off the fingertips of the catcher's mitt. That'll be a advanced runner, and the count is now 1-1. Buonaiuto at second, swung on by Vayu. It's 1-2. All of Guelph cheering on Nunez and the Royals, and Vayu needed time, but the hands don't stop. 1-2 delivered. High and off the plate, it's 2-2, and maybe hoping Vayu would feel the pressure and chase one, but laid off. The count's even, 2-2, and the hands refuse to quit. That one not getting the call, and my oh my, there's a handful of disappointed and irritated Royals fans, and Jeffrey Nunez seems to be on the same page about that one, but the never-ending claps. Payoff. Sky to right field, and Terrasano points to it. Williams underneath it. Makes the catch, and Nunez and the Royals get out of it. This game remains tied. We're halfway through eight innings. We'll be back with the bottom of the eighth after this.
Corbin Peters into the game on the mound for the Cardinals. Ashton Patterson, Dalton Pompey, and Sean Riley due up. It's the bottom of the eighth in a tie ball game, 4-4. That is do or die. Deciding game five, going down to the wire. Peters sets. Doesn't like what he saw from Burnside behind home plate. And gives him the old John Cena, you can't see me. Waves him off. We'll do it again here. As Peters now delivers his first pitch of the game. It's inside on Patterson to make it 1-0. And not that it's been the first time this summer to stating the obvious by myself, but this is huge. That's a called strike as Patterson showed bunt, but pulled back, and it was still a called strike. Yeah. Peters now delivers, and that's off the plate to make it 2-1. So we have a bit of technical difficulty with our camera here, and we'll try to sort that out ASAP, obviously. 2-1 coming. That's a called strike to even the count at 2-2, and Ashton Patterson very, very flamboyant about his opinions on these called balls and strikes. Not making it a secret. 2-2 the count, no one gone. Patterson leading off here in the bottom of the eighth. That's a called strike three, and Ashton doesn't like it. He will head back to the dugout. And we will flip the order over. Dalton Pompey with one gone here. Back to the dish. He opened the scoring in this ball game. He's 1-3.
Pompey came into action batting 523 in the postseason and just been letting the spark night after night in this postseason games anyways. He's definitely leading the charge.
He finds a way to get it done in big clutch moments. Go back to 2015 and you'll see exactly what I mean. Swings at one, makes contact, but at strike number one, as it went nowhere.
Of course, he made his major league debut 8 years ago tonight, actually.
Does lightning strike twice? It's 0-2. Major league debut back in 2014 and a chance to give Guelph the lead and perhaps cement their first series win in oh so long. Pompey checks the swing, that one in the dirt. They tried to appeal down to third. It's 1-2. It didn't seem like it was anywhere near close to being a full swing. And this crowd, nervous and silent for the most part. Peters sets, delivers the 1-2. Pompey lays off it. It's a ball. It's 2-2. Count even, one gone, Riley on deck. Pompey calls time, steps out, and resets. Pompey getting the encouragement from some hometown fans here. The 2-2 coming. Pompey, excuse me, swing down the third base line. That'll be out of play, and one of the fans on the track.
We got to remind the fans to stay off the track that's in play here.
May have prevented a ball that was in play from being
umpire. The fielder would have collided with the fan out there, could have called Pompey out on fan interference.
Count remains 2-2. Game remains tied 4-4. Do it again here. Peters the 2-2 for the third time. And another, excuse me, swing down the third base line. That one well out of play. As the old age chants start, and I think Dalton doesn't feel it, you're dead wrong. 2-2 yet again. Pompey steps back in. Peters sets. Pompey.
on pay. Chases one and wanted it, but couldn't get it. That is a strikeout for Corbin Peters on Dalton Pompey. Back-to-back strikeouts for Corbin Peters to start this ball game, and it'd be a tall task to make it three in a row with Sean Riley coming to the plate and potentially his final game as a Royal and in the IBL. Not gonna just go quietly into the night, I promise you that. One way off the plate and called a strike, but not sure where that caught it, but apparently it did. It's 0-1.
Great job by Burnside to hold that corner up there to let the umpire make that call too.
Riley to left field, high, deep in, caught, not caught, dropped. Sean Riley to second. That one had home run written all over it, but just seemed to die in the
left fielder has definitely gone down in a heap of pain here. Trainer on his way out, so his manager Jeff Lonsberg to check on his left fielder.
That was Dennis DeBanning that chased that one down and nearly made the catch. That was not quite to the warning track, but in terms of where it was hit on the bat, inches away from breaking this tie.
Owen Ellis is going to pinch run here for Sean Riley. Yep. The Royals going to try to go for the win here with Connor Morrow coming to the plate.
Morrow would be followed by Collymore. But with two gone, Owen Ellis with a Dalton Pompey size plate in front of him. Let's go back to 2015 real quick, Neil. We have some time here while DeBanning gets 10-2. Would it not be full circle?
Yep. Not,
I don't think for a minute that Owen Ellis wasn't in the ear of Dalton Pompey saying, what do I do?
Exactly.
As DeBanning now back to his feet, and not sure if he will stay in this ball game or be lifted.
Looks like he's coming out. Yep.
Yeah, he is coming in for sure now, so I wasn't quite sure if that was teammate or DeBanning himself. But
I'm turning for Riley, Owen Ellis.
Owen Ellis will run from second. He's in scoring position, two gone, and Connor Morrow hitting well over 300. What was the number, Neil, coming into this game? 355, I think you said?
Yeah, something like that, yeah. 454, actually.
454, so just a tinge higher than what I just said. So Morrow, who is 1-for-2 with a run scored.
Number 2, Connor Morrow.
Right around his average for the postseason. Will look to really cement his legacy in his first year as a Royal here.
Ellis has to get a big enough lead here, but not to draw attention to himself out there.
Do not want to get picked off in this scenario, certainly no. Corbin Peters may check him first. We will see. That one off the plate for a ball. 1-0. Renault did run over to second to kind of give Owen Ellis a second thought about where he was standing, and we'll see if that comes into play here in the 1-0. Bit of mind games happening out there with the young Ellis. Morrow, that'll be a fly ball and an out. As Tyler Duncan was jotty on the spot to make the fly ball catch. That could have been trouble, but Duncan all over it to record the out. We're off to the ninth inning in a tie ball game, 4-4. We'll be back with more.
Robin Fox Pappas will lead it off here in the top of the ninth inning for the Hamilton Cardinals, and most important inning of this entire season so far. And Jeffrey Nunez gets it started with the first pitch strike on Fox Pappas. The 0-1 swung on by Fox Pappas and way off the mark. It's 0-2. The Royals had a glorious couple of chances to break this tie, and that one misses. It's 1-2 now. Glorious chances in the bottom of the eighth, but it was all for naught. As Sean Riley's high fly ball to left field stayed in the park. Owen Ellis came in to run, and Connor Morrow, with a good piece of hitting, was taken away by Tyler Duncan out in center to end the bottom of the eighth. And now we're at 2-2, Fox Pappas and Nunez. Fox Pappas, high fly ball to right. JD underneath it. Williams makes the easy catch for out number one. Jacob Underwood will be next. Dennis DeBanning would have been to follow, however, he is out of the ball game after making that attempted diving catch on Sean Riley's fly ball half an inning ago. Pardon me, Dennis DeBanning, the Iron Man, is on deck. We thought he had left the game, but clearly mistaken. Underwood fouls one high and straight back behind him. Nunez, not sure if he likes the ball that he was given by the home plate umpire, but will return to his perch on the mound here, ahead of Underwood, 0-1. One gone already. Nunez, Underwood to no man's land, and that one thrown away. Barless and Tarasano could not make the play, and it looked like kind of a bouncy castle out there as both of them barrel rolled in between it, and Barless made a hope play back towards the middle of the infield. But thankfully for the Royals, Underwood had nowhere to go. He is aboard with a one-out single. We're back to the top of the order. It's Dennis DeBanning. Four, four, one gone, one on. DeBanning from Nunez inside, he hit him. It's really just been Jekyll and Hyde for Jeffrey Nunez in this ball game, and not the time. For that to be happening, Nunez needs to resettle back in. We've seen the potential and the composure of him throughout this outing in relief of Claudio Custodio, but in a tie game in the top of the ninth, two on now, one gone, and Louis Jean coming to the plate. It's gut check time for Nunez and Keys and the other Royals that are on the field, and just need to support their pitcher and make sure if anything is hit high and deep, they get underneath it. Dalton Pompey, definitely the guy who won out there at center. Ashton Patterson in left. J.D. Williams out in right. Nunez delivers, and that one off the plate for a ball. This game has become silent. This crowd even more nervous than before. Two on now, and Jean ahead in the count 1-0, and just one gone. The go-ahead run 180 feet away. Need a ground ball here. That one again. Nothing to swing at if you're Sean, so it's 2-0. The ground ball would again get Guelph out of it. Collymore, DeGrace, and Interesano would be up next, or Keys, excuse me. Collymore, Keys, and Interesano would be due up in the bottom half of this inning, and that's also not going to do it, so it's 3-0 now. Jeffrey Nunez feeling the heat. Louis Jean taking a lap. Th- 3-0 the count. Nunez sets, exhales, winds, delivers. It's a four-pitch walk for Louis Jean. The bases are now loaded with one out. And guess who? Number 55, the center fielder, and call him Hamlet, call him Macbeth, whatever one killed royalty, that's Tyler Duncan, has been an absolute murderer of Royals momentum of this postseason, and probably is happy to welcome this opportunity with a chance to blow this game wide open his team's way, who was trailing 4-0 at one point. Clawed their way back into it to tie it, and now have consistently been able to chip away and find a way aboard. And bases juice for a guy who isn't going to feel any sort of pressure or nerves walking into the box for his fifth time tonight. Although Duncan does have 3 strikeouts, so we will consider that a silver lining. But right now, Tyler Duncan thinking about anything but a strikeout. Nunez delivers off the plate. Nowhere to put Duncan. Only one out. Still not getting the call. 2-0. Jeffrey Nunez delivers the 2-0. Gets the called strike. Gets a relieving one at that. Definitely easier said than done for Nunez, with a huge, huge crowd there from outfield wall all the way around outfield wall and many rows deep. That's swung on by Duncan, and Nunez is at 2-2. Tyler Duncan, not sure if he's frustrated or knows that he was just a heartbeat away from making contact with that baseball. Hands come together. Nunez feels the support. Gives Keys the nod, delivers the pitch. Doesn't get the call, and the count is now full. If you're Tyler Duncan with just one out, you wonder if you just make Nunez find the strike zone or if you just see if he'll walk one home. Swung on and missed! Jeffrey Nunez! He liked that one. As did every single Royals fan in attendance. Lane Renaud to the plate, and no slouch either, but also with 3 strikeouts. It's 1-for-4. Singled and was left hanging at second, the only time he did reach base. So if Nunez can somehow find a way out of this without giving up a run, that would be huge. Renaud swings, and listen to this crowd. Bend but don't break. Somehow doesn't get the call. That looked like a strike in the zone. But Renaud went a quarter of the way around, so count's now even. Home fans don't like it, and that is no surprise, but 1-1 now. Nunez with the support of everyone here. Swung on by Renaud. He's a strike away. His body language has changed. His demeanor has changed. His swagger has changed in the last 8 pitches. Hands and feet going. The 1-2. Swung on. He's out of it. Sits him down. Leaves the bases loaded. Jeffrey Nunez may have just won the Guelph Royals this baseball game. We're off to the bottom of the 9th inning.
all tied up at four. And Terrasano, Collymore will lead it off, followed by Keys and Terrasano all due up.
Bottom of the ninth inning in a 4-4 ball game. Malik Collymore to lead it off. Probably the first guy that Guelph would pick as Corbin Peters continues to loosen up. And now he is in the hot seat on the mound as Jeffrey Nunez was feeling the heat in the top of the ninth inning. Bases loaded, one out, back-to-back strikeouts, and really brought this crowd alive. The contrast in terms of nervousness and excitement that we've been able to witness tonight has been nothing short of amazing.
A little feral, I guess, for a glass case of emotions here.
As Neil Srivastava has handed over his headset to me because one of ours may have been broken by a pair of Crocs or two. Says that we are in a glass case of emotion up here in the booth. Malik Collymore takes a long, slow walk to the batter's box. And the thing about Malik is that he's not just a power hitter. If he gets on base, he can bunt for a base hit and steal second. Then he's in scoring position, and two deep fly balls would win this game and put the Royals into the second round. Shows bunt, pulls back, it misses. It's 1-0. Corbin Peters, who did a great job against the Royals in game two and held them off the board so far in this outing. Collymore, two very different approaches to his at-bat so far, and is looking to put that one all the way down to Welland and let them know where they'd be coming tomorrow night, but was just a little bit offbeat. 1-1 now. Collymore to Jean at short. Jean, it will be a bang bang play. Collymore, not in time. He's down for out number one. That one had a chance, especially with the foot speed of Malik, but Louis Jean equal to the task. 6-3 put out for out number one. Brendan Keys, who came into this game in relief of Kyle DeGrace after Claudio Custodio exited. He's done a great job defensively. Looking to make an impact offensively. Keys high fly ball, but not that deep. Jean takes his hat off and makes the catch for a quick out number two. And yet again, the contrast of this crowd's energy continues to be evident.
Number 24, Justin Interessano.
Tarasano, who had that three-run moonshot back in the fourth inning. With two out, we'll be looking to emulate exactly that or just get on base. Number of capable hitters to come in and capable runners to come in for this Royals team in the dugout, so don't try to do too much. Peters delivers. It's low, 1-0. A lot of nervous fans here. The good news is our resident photographer, Gar Fitzgerald, also a very capable paramedic. 1-0 from Peters. Tarasano just late on it. It's 1-1 as he fouls it off. These fans have got their money's worth so far. Peters sets, exhales, delivers the 1-1. It's inside on Tarasano, who I think that home run has really calmed himself down and not trying to get the monkey off his back, so to speak, and is now looking for the pitch he wants rather than chasing one. That's a called strike on the very, very outside part of the plate to even the count at 2-2, and Peters is now a strike away from sending us to extra baseball. Two-two coming from Corbin Peters shortly. Way off the plate. We're going down to the wire. Counts full and Tarasano will take it in. Justin Tarasano grew up playing baseball here as a Griffin, as a junior Royal, as a Silver Creek, and now as a Royal. Looks at one and is on his way to first and represents the winning run with J.D. Williams looking to drive him in. Two out, and Tarasano at first. I'd be surprised if Dino Rommel didn't excuse Justin Tarasano from this game for a pinch runner. Looks like Tarasano will remain on the base path, which is perhaps just the tip of the cap to Juicy. Williams swings at the first pitch he sees. It's down the right field line and out of play. Tarasano is off with the crack of the bat and seemed to be quite fleet of foot there. 0-1. A much slower return to first base from Tarasano. Absolutely. Might ask JD to call time here, just in case. Peters sets and delivers the 0-1. It's 0-2 after Williams fouls that one straight back. Darius Bartlis would be next. Peter's not likely to leave one hanging for JD to finish this game on one swing of the bat, but 0-2 coming. Swung on and missed, and the Cardinals are sending this game to extra innings after a heck of an inning pitch by Corbin Peters. We will be back with the top of the 10th in the fifth and final game of the quarterfinal between Hamilton and Guelph.
Cardinals start the bottom, or the top of the 10th inning with a leadoff single here. As Ryan Burnside hits the first pitch from Jeffrey Nunez, he sees into the right field for a single. And the Cardinals have got the go-ahead run here in the 10th inning. On board here for Anthony Bonanotto. Of course, there's no extra inning rules in postseason here, so. Nunez will work here. It's an 0-1 count here. Count is even at 1-1. One gets way past Nunez and past Keys anyways, and Burnside will make his way down to second base on a wild pitch. Count now 2-2. Now the infield will come in at least the corners anyways, expecting the bunt here. McCollymore will have to stay at third shortstop, and everybody else will have to wheel around here. This one's popped foul, and the count is 2-2.
Out 2-2 now, and again, tense moments here in Hastings Stadium for the umpteenth time so far this evening. That one's fouled back, and the count will remain the same. Buonaiuto looking to give the Hamilton Cardinals their first lead of the game. Owens on the ground to Barless at second. Checks his man at third, goes over to Terrasano for the easy out number one at first. Now Jeremy Ballou with a man at third and one out can accomplish exactly that feat that Hamilton has yet to be able to accomplish, which is give his team the lead here. Infield in. Be looking just to throw the man or keep the man at third and get the easy out at first. That one inside from Nunez, and Velu probably could have ducked into it and given himself a free bag. That one up the middle. Morrow checks his man at third, holds him off, and what a play. Kept Connor Burnside at bay at third, and then threw over to Terrasano for the second out of the inning, and now what a swing of events there. That is why I'm the founder, CEO, president, and chairman of the Connor Morrow Fan Club. If you want to sign up, apply within. Always welcoming new members, as the Royals are now an out away with Robin Fox Pappas at the plate. Low outside off the plate for a ball. Fox Pappas has struck out twice this evening. He's 1-for-4, has scored a run. That one also doesn't get the call, won't get it done, 2-0. Nunez needs a bit of support from the crowd to get his confidence back. 3-0. Hopefully. 3-0. Fox Pappas knows how much this next pitch means. So does Nunez. So does Burnside at third. That one inside. It keeps the man at third. But now runners at the corners with two gone. So a play at second, a play at first, and a play at home to be made. Jacob Underwood, the number 9 hitter in the lineup, with a chance to really give himself something to remember in his baseball career for sure. Probably the biggest at-bat of his baseball career ever coming up very shortly after a mound visit from the infield plus Dino Rommel to Jeffrey Nunez. Nervous moments from the front row, actually from the dugout to the baselines all the way up to the press box and through the speakers as everyone is just kind of not really sure what to do. They don't want to move too much or miss anything, but it's almost like walking on eggshells, as I mentioned earlier. Underwood to the plate. Nunez checks his man, Fox Pappas, at first. Burnside represents the go-ahead run. Swung on by Underwood and missed. And these timely mound visits from Dino Rommel have been effective as possible this evening with Jeffrey Nunez. We'll see if this one rings true yet again. It's 0-1. Fox Pappas takes off for second, not challenged, and will take his base. So now the force out at second is null and void. Great heads-up base running from Fox Pappas. 1-1. Now it's 2-1. Underwood steps back in. Nunez looking for another strike or a pop-up or anything to an outfielder. J.D. Williams misread the ball, and that's going to score multiple runs. Underwood on his way to third. Both Burnside and Fox Pappas have come in to score. It's 6-4. J.D. Williams must have lost it in the light. He ran in when he should have been running backward, and it's an unfortunate mistake that is going to cost the Royals two runs, and they would have been out of this inning and a chance to win had that not happened. But as we move on, it is now a man at third with two out, and we're back to the top of the order. DeBenning pops one into foul territory, and it is out of play. And to say this Hastings Stadium crowd is stunned would be an understatement. 0-1. No Sean Riley left in the game in the lineup. He was yanked for Owen Ellis in the ninth inning. It's 0-2. Still a number of capable bats in the Royals dugout that could be brought into this game to either extend it or win it in the bottom half, and that's popped up, and Benning stays alive. This series has been everything and more that anyone could have imagined. So regardless now, it's 6-4 Hamilton, and to say it was anything but boring would be an understatement. Much like that pitch slips away from Nunez and behind DeBenning to make it 1-2. Nunez clearly rattled by that last at bat, and now getting encouragement from the Hastings crowd, who have gotten absolutely nowhere. They'll be with us all night long. Strikes him out! Dennis DeBenning down on strikes. Hamilton brings two home. Guelph has some work to do. We're off to the bottom of the 10th inning from Hastings Stadium. Darius Barlas will start off the bottom of the 10th inning, which is quite literally Guelph's last chance. Down 6-4 now after a two-run top of the 10th from Hamilton, who, as frustrated as the Royals have become, caps off to the Cardinals because they have just done a great job of frustrating and sticking around and then winning games. And right now, three outs away from a meeting with the London Majors in less than 24 hours. But Darius Barlas, Ashton Patterson, and Dalton Pompey all have something to say about that. Barlas takes one for a strike called on at the knees on the inside part of the plate. It's 0-1. Peters gets Barlas to chase for strike two, and he's making quick work of the first batter he is facing here in the bottom of the 10th. And Corbin Peters, a very formidable pitcher that probably the guy that Hamilton wants on the mound right now. Darius Barlas fights one off and stays alive. Barlas steps out and returns to the box. Peters sets. Barlas waves at one. Hamilton is two outs away. Ashton Patterson and Dalton Pompey also due up in this inning. If one or both can get aboard, it would definitely bring some life back into this building. Again, do not forget Sean Riley was lifted for Owen Ellis in the bottom of the 9th inning, so he is no longer available in the two hole. We'll see if Dino Rommel sticks with Ellis if we get that far. Patterson takes a ball inside and is ahead 1-0. It's 2-0. Peters sets. Peters delivers. It's 3-0. A four-pitch walk for Ashton Patterson. Great patience at the plate, and now a whole heap of speed at first. And Dalton Pompey to the plate. One gone. And every single fan out of their seats and on their toes. Owen Ellis on deck behind Pompey. Pompey pulls one and it's just fouled on the first baseline and wasting no time whatsoever. Pompey, a very patient man at the plate, but showing that he is not at all intimidated by Corbin Peters or this scenario. Anything to write would likely give Patterson a chance to score. That one sky to left field. That has a chance to drop. The catch is made, so Ashton Patterson returns to first. And that might have been the Royals' chance, but Owen Ellis, with the weight of the city and perhaps the world on his shoulders, all he has to do is give Connor Morrow a chance to get to the plate. Steps into this game, and what a time to make your arrival. Ellis also a Silver Creek, much like Patterson at first, so thrown into the deep end are these young kids. That one low and in the dirt inside. It's a ball. For all of those reasons, it's 1-0. two gone. Ellis looks at another one off the plate. It's 2-0. Corbin Peters having some difficulty with these young hitters. Ellis swung at one that was likely a called strike either way. It's 2-1. And I think everyone's breathing just a little bit shallow right about now. 2-1. Ellis skies one to shallow left. Jean again loses his hat. That catch is made, and Hamilton is off to London for a meeting with the majors in 24 hours. The Guelph Royals, yet again, a early exit from the playoffs, and a heartbreaker to say the least. A fantastic season from a team that went 19-2 at home, but lost 2 of 3 here in the first round to Hamilton and gave up a 4-run lead. For all of those reasons and more, they are now going home early. Sean Riley's career has come to an end. It's been a glorious one at that. The teams will shake hands. We will thank you for tuning in every night and save. Good evening, and thank you for the very last time. On behalf of Neil Srivastava, I'm Scott Fraser. We'll see you next summer.